I am, Mr. Tarrou. If you've made it this far through AP Statistics or whatever statistics course you are in, you have made it to the downhill slope. I'm going to stop throwing massive amounts of concepts at you at every chapter or every set of notes, because we're at the point now where we're going to be learning how to handle proportions and means, and both of those variables are basically probability calculations are going to be either T or Z scores. Those are almost exactly the same. And a lot of bell curve calculations. So a lot of Z scores or T scores, a lot, they're all pretty much going to be bell curve calculations until you learn something called the chi-square test. So these chapters that follow or coming up for my class, it's going to be the next four or five chapters, are going to be very repetitive in nature. So it's really going to give you a chance to reinforce what you learned for a semester and really start using it in complete problems. Now, we have learned something called the binomial setting and learned how to calculate binomial counts. And we've learned something called normal approximation with binomial counts. Well, we're now going to start talking about sample proportions, which is the binomial setting, except for instead of the variable being recorded as the number of counts, it's going to be the percent. So we're definitely on the downhill slope now. Lot smaller, the information is going to be given to you now in a lot smaller chunks, and your homework is going to become more repetitive. So hopefully it lets you reinforce those concepts we've already learned. Sample proportions. This is basically a review of the binomial setting, except for the, instead of the variable being defined as a number of successes, it is the proportion of successes. Okay, well, in the binomial count setting, a lot of times we use these commands. We are only going to be working with proportions when the work with those proportions are only going to be done using something called normal approximation, and you did learn that when we talked about the binomial setting and binomial counts. The reason why all proportion work is going to be involving the normal approximation process, z-scores basically, is the calculator commands of binom PDF and binom CDF, those commands that gave us probabilities of one specific outcome or a cumulative series of outcomes, those only work when the x, the variable, is defined as the number of successes, not the proportion of successes. And they do give exact value answers, so that's very, very nice, but again, they only work with counts. Proportions. There are only two possible outcomes for each observation of trial. I've got this note here because now we have started to learn the different types of variables that we'll be dealing with in statistics, such as you had a mean and standard deviation formula for the discrete random variable. Mean of x equals the summation of x sub I times p sub I, and the standard deviation of x is the square root of the sum of x sub I minus the mean of x squared, and then that multiplied by p sub I. Well, those formulas, just as that pair of formulas, for example, only is applicable, you only use them when you have a PDF chart, a list of all those outcomes and a list of all those probabilities. So when you read a question, and I've already started to talk about this when we do the binomial counts, or when we did them, you've really got to read these questions carefully and, you know why is this question in this section. You know, not that I'm doing chapter, you know, blank, section blank, and that's why I'm doing binomial proportions, but you're reading the question and you're recognizing that for every trial, every observation, there's only two possible outcomes. There's a set number of observations, and I'm going to start saying the checks that are on the next screen, but really read the question and understand, why is this question in this section? Why is this question a binomial proportion? Or back in chapter, our previous chapter, why are these questions binomial counts? The next topic we're going to learn is called, we're going to learn how to deal with means. Like if you're filling up six bottles of soda and you're measuring the amount of ounces of soda per bottle, you know how that's not going to have just two outcomes when you're measuring the number of ounces per bottle, and maybe you want to find the average fill of six bottles of soda. You know, why is that working with means and not working with proportions? Well, the biggest deal is, again, each observation, each trial only has two outcomes. Now there's four checks for the binomial setting, not just one, so let's review those. Okay. While I will be emphasizing that you remember all four checks of a binomial setting, the particular textbook I'm using, the current addition, it only really marks off two rules of thumb. The full binomial setting is that there's two outcomes per observation or trial. There's a set number of observations. Remember, geometric is when you went until you obtained your first success, but in a binomial setting, which is much more common in our class dealing with it, there's a set number of observations of n. I'm going to ask 300 people this question. I'm going to run this experiment, this pass-fail experiment, 50 times. Set number of observations. Independence. Now, I actually pretty much include this first rule of thumb, as my book calls it, in my independence check. A lot of times with independence, I'll be able to say, well, the selection process was an SRS, or assuming that there was an SRS taken, the trials will be independent, or the observations will be independent, as long as the population is over 10 times the sample size. So I normally include this rule of thumb, along with the SRS idea, with independence. Remember, we can only, since this is only intro to statistics, we will only be analyzing data that is collected with an SRS, a simple random sample, not things like maybe a stratified random sample. That's a good sampling technique, but we do not know how to deal with that kind of data, not in this class. And a constant probability of success. And then finally, if we're going to be doing normal approximation, if we're going to be doing z-scores, we have to make sure the data is indeed normal, and there's two checks for that. N times p is greater than 10 or equal to, and n times 1 minus p is also greater than or equal to 10. Now the book is pointing, that I'm currently using, is pointing out two rules of thumb. Population over 10 times the sample size, you've heard me say this many, many times, this condition must be met for any of the standard deviation formulas to work, because it's required with the idea of independent trials. And you need to check for normality. Now one thing that's not mentioned, again I just said it, is our data must be from an SRS. There's other valid sampling techniques, but for actually working with data at this level of statistics, the data must have come from an SRS. I got one more page, and then after that, the next video is going to be an example of how to actually run these calculations. All right? Bye! This first video is relatively short because I did not have enough room to write out the example. So, the mean or expected value, same things, this phrase means mean, find the average, of a population proportion, the mean of p is equal to p hat. P hat is kind of like expected value, like y hat is with a regression line, but with proportions, p hat is our sample proportion. Capital P is population proportion, p hat is the sample proportion. And the standard deviation for a standard the standard deviation of a proportion, and notice we're using mu and sigma. We always use mu and sigma when calculating mean and standard deviation of a proportion. That's going to change a little bit when we work with means. So just be aware of that. But we're not right now, so mu and p is equal to the square root of p times 1 minus p over n. Now, note, this formula calls for p, the population proportion, not p hat, the sample proportion. The only time you use p hat is when you're calculating a confidence interval to estimate the population proportion. So I'm kind of giving you a hint to a concept that you're going to see in the future. We are going to be making confidence intervals soon, and the sole purpose of a confidence interval is to estimate the population proportion. Now, if you're doing something called a significance test, which you don't, I've never used that phrase really yet, so let me just say this. When you're told what the proportion or the probability of success is, when the question tells you that, you are being told what the population proportion is. So if I say that 40% of the population does blank, then p equals 0.4. And then when you, if you want to test that claim and collect data through a sampling process, that sample proportion that you collect is going to be p hat. So if you're given, or when you're given, the population or the proportion of success from the question, that is going to be labeled as p. When we learn significance tests, that'll be like something like a shipping company claims that 95% of their packages arrive on time. P equals 0.95. then you go to test that claim, maybe you only find that 91% show up on time, so that would be p hat, your sample proportion, is 0.91. But when you calculate the standard deviation of the proportion, you always use the population proportion given to you. Even if later on in the problem you realize through a significance test that you've shown that there's evidence that the given information was false. Whatever p is given in the first place, that capital P is what you use to calculate standard deviation unless you're doing a confidence interval. And I don't want to talk too much about that because it's not in, well, we're not going to do it tonight's, in this example that's about to come up. All right, so anyway, Mr. Tura, I'm babbling on. Bam! Watch my examples.
Or go do your homework.